Hello and welcome to another episode of On Your Mark. Today's arc is Killer Cure, number 459581 by Samuraiko. And for this author's cut, she has joined me here today. This arc was created for Dr. Aeon's third challenge, which was to show a villain's redemption or a hero's fall from grace. Did you have to do anything differently than you would if you were just writing this for yourself?
Yeah, I had to think about what would constitute a villain redeeming him or herself. If I wasn't sure how I was going to have them redeem themselves, I had to define how they would be evil in the first place. For Disillusion, the fact that she was evil and that she had fallen from grace and she still thought she was doing the right thing meant if she was going to have to do the right thing in reverse, which meant letting people live that normally we wouldn't want to.
You chose for your contact Rebecca Brunel, which I believe is the old science starting contact in Galaxy City. What made you choose her for a high-level arc?
Because she comes back, she's the original, one of the two FBSA science contacts. And you run into her again when you do the arc, the higher-level arc for Stephen Sheridan called The Organ Grinders. And she is your contact with Seraph that gets you Omega level clearance during that arc. So I thought, you know what, let's go back and touch on this. And, you know, she knows, you know, what the Rikti really are. She was really the only contact that would work there. So it just made sense to choose her.
You make references to Galaxy City in a couple places. Now that it's destroyed in-game, do you think you'll update the arc to fit it with the current game continuity?
I probably will. Just because I've actually had people ask if I'd ever write a sequel. And if so, then yeah, I'd want the arc to stay current. First inclination, I'd say yeah, but there's still a part of me that would be going, the option of if a second arc were created, of now Rebecca Brunel is in Atlas with everybody else and referencing the fact that since then Galaxy City's been destroyed. It's really kind of up in the air.
The Seraph lab map is a really great looking map and one that I still haven't seen outside of this arc. How did you come about choosing that map?
I thought, you know, I want something cool for that. And I thought, you know, maybe I had just done the Organ Grinders or something. And I was like, I wonder if that map is available in the AE. And so I went through and I was looking at other potential science maps. And I said, you know what, if they're going to steal it from somewhere, why don't they just steal it from Seraph headquarters if it's available? And then I'm like, oh my God, the map is actually there. And so I went in and I ran it as an empty map because I'm like, okay, you know, where is it? And I felt like such an idiot because I couldn't find the way inside. And then I'm inside. I'm like, oh, okay, now this works a little bit better. It just worked. It was just the fact of, okay, this is in fact Seraph headquarters. And it's not just me picking random, you know, abandoned tech or tech map X and calling it, okay, yes, this is headquarters as it's so often seen. It's no, this is actually their building.
You chose Knives of Artemis and Malta as two of the enemy groups you face in this arc. They're also a couple of the least liked groups to fight. What made you choose these two groups, and how important do you think choosing the right enemy groups to fight are to an arc story?
I thought, well, if you're going to hire someone to screw over the FBSA and Vanguard by stealing information, and hey, if you pick up any nifty tech while you're in there, you're welcome to hold on to it. It was easily going to be those two. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people, as annoying as they find the Knives of Artemis and Malta, people never said, I can't believe that we're fighting them because it doesn't make sense. They just didn't like fighting them because everyone hates, you know, Reign of Caltrops and Sappers. But that having enemy groups in there working for money, okay, yeah, if you're going to pick two mercenary groups, they were going to be it.
Mission 3 is one thing I think is great to see in AE, a non-combat or combat-light mission. Here you have a mostly empty map with a lot of glowies and a handful of ambushes and patrols. Some people criticize them for their lack of XP, but what do you think about them?
I actually like them. I can understand the point that people have. Sometimes you really do need a downbeat in a storyline of the, you know, where you're not running and constantly, you know, running, jumping, trying to plow into everything, because it gives you a little bit of time to mull over stuff as you're going through, and you're, you know, as you're finding clues, you have a little more time to think about them. You know, how many times have you ever played an arc, whether it's an AE arc or in game, where everything happens so fast, and you're finding clues and you're fighting mobs and you're doing this, and you get to the end of the mission and you're like, what did I miss? I figured I was going to write it based on a good story rather than someone trying to farm it. And a lot of people liked that kind of more subtle pause of the, you know, you've learned stuff and you didn't even really have to kill anybody. And you still thought there were too many casualties as it was, because people were dying and there wasn't really a thing you could do about it.
I really like how you referenced some of the earlier canon missions, especially the Lost Kirin One mission.
I love going back and referencing earlier things, because then people go, oh, where was that? And then they want to go look, and then they want to go play that part of the game again. And it's little details like that that I just love, of tying the canon into each other, especially when it makes sense. I didn't want it to be forced. If it's forced, it feels so awful in a game, really.
And I think Dissolution is a great character that has a well-fleshed-out story and motivation. Can you tell us a little bit about your inspiration for that character?
I had tinkered with the idea of actually that power set as soon as I found out that the mission architect lets you create sets you couldn't do in the game, and I thought, oh, that'd be so cool. And so I thought, okay, what would a Psy Poison Corruptor be like? And the idea that she had been mutated to some degree by the Rikti was there almost early on. But then I thought, okay, well, why would she be? And then I thought, well, what would happen if she let herself do it just so she could understand the Rikti that much better to destroy them? And her whole story, her name and everything just came together in one big rush.
I'd like to thank you for joining me here today.
You're welcome.
And thank you for watching today. Let me know in your comments which author you'd like to hear from in the future. This is Bubba Wheat. Until next time.
I'll remove the cores. But not the symptom.